1975, he should not have stopped. He should have continued training the entire year, stayed at the body weight where he was at the Olympia, trained and trained and trained 4 hours a day. He would have beaten, you know, anyone in 1976, and he would have beaten anyone in 1977, all the way up to 1980, and who knows how much longer. If he would have continued training the way I was talking about, there would have been no one in the world that would have been as good as he was, and there would have been no one around in the future that would have been as good as he was.
World Gym, Venice, California, a popular hub where many professional athletes and bodybuilders come to train.
Better shoes on. I could have.
Should have had the lifts.
Well, I should have had the pump.
Well, better.
How you doing?
Getting ready for the match for Olympia.
Really?
Yeah.
So how much longer do you have to go?
I'd say about 4.5-5 months now.
It had to happen. You couldn't just put a guy over 40 out to pasture. Not in this sport. In this sport, you can't do it because guys got better after 40. Louis looks better today when he competed the last time than he did when he competed in his so-called heyday in Europe when he won the universe. Definitely, he's better today. So we didn't see his full potential when he was in his early 20s or in the late 20s. We've seen it now. Imagine we had to wait all this time to see his full potential, the way he blocked, late bloomer.
Couple of long sets.
What are we doing,
shoulders? Shoulders and arms. Okay, it's two long sets.
What do you want to do? Let's get doing it.
Come on, stay with it. Get up. Easy, come on. Again. Good. Come on. Up. Go. These two. Four more. Come on. Okay. All right. Now slow. All right, two more.
One more.
Go easy. I didn't do nothing. One more.
Fight it.
Oh, yeah, fight it. Down slow. Yeah. I got it. Now. Your top, stretch the bottom. And down, good. Come on, stay with it. Easy kick. Lock it down. Come on. Come on. Good. One more. Come on. Good. One more. Lock it up. Finish it.
Good. Good.
Good. Good.
Good.
Good.
Lou Ferrigno, 43 years old, 310 pounds, 6 feet 5 inches, making Lou the largest bodybuilder to have ever competed. Assisted by his best friend Ira Bankowski, Lou has emerged from a 19-year retirement to compete in this year's Masters Olympia.
The main reason why I came back is because I didn't want people to think I was a has-been. I really want to turn this into my ultimate dream to be a world champion again after over the age of 40, because I never won Mr. Olympia and I want to be the best. The reason why people want to be Mr. Olympia because they want to say, I am the best built man on the planet, the world, the best of the best. There's only one Mr. Olympia. You can be Mr. Universe, you can be Mr. America, you can win the national. But Mr. Olympia means you are number one.
Let's go. 10 good ones. Hold it. There you go. Everyone just like that. Yeah. Hold it.
Good.
Hold it.
The Masters Olympia is really the Super Bowl of professional bodybuilding. It was an idea that Joe Weider had thought about for a really long time, and it was to bring back all these former greats who had been in a previous Olympia. And what it was to get all these all-time greats that many of the people remembered going back as much as 20 or 25 years, to get them on stage again.
One. It's a long one. Two.
Well, I think that I can totally understand if anyone wants to come back and compete in the Mr. Olympia competition. It is just a very
Arnold Schwarzenegger, 7-time Mr. Olympia.
To come back out of retirement and to get back into the swing again and to get that momentum going and the rhythm going of training and to create the hunger, which is the most important thing, to create the will and the hunger to train 4 or 5 hours a day and to be that competitive when you get to the competition, that you would do anything possible. No matter how much posing you have to do, or how much training you have to do, or how much dieting you have to do, you will do it. That is the kind of will and hunger that you need.
Go! Come on. Up. Excellent. Good. Hold it at the top.
If you fall short by 5%, you're going to lose the competition. So that's the most dangerous thing to do, is to go back and maybe not create that hunger and that will anymore. And I think that is the obstacle that Lou Ferrigno has to overcome.
Slow.
Important thing is on stage, you want to be in the best shape, but everything is in the mind. So I felt that what Ira and I put together, no one knows better than the two of us. But I put myself in a position, okay, I'm not going to fight with you for the contest. You see, I really need something to do, tell me. Because in the past, I will fight with him because I want to make sure to be a winner. I have to maximize every body part. I will pose for him after every workout. He would check my clock list. But the most important thing is this time compared to years ago is the mind. Putting the mind into it that nothing's going to stop us. If you got pain, you work around the pain, you wrap it, you ice it, you got to do it.
Then the three judges standing in there, you have that folding.
It looks fine. It looks very good. I like it. A little bit more of a line, a little bit more separation. All right, come on, Dean. Last set. Let's go.
Chris, I think it's a real exciting contest. I know that I'm just really anxious to go see it. I was originally invited.
Don Ross, bodybuilding journalist.
They said that Wayne D'Amelio said he wants to keep it to just former Olympia contenders. Or people that have been in the Olympia. So what we're going to see now is people that you've read about for years and years in magazines. For the competitors themselves, it's going to be like a high school reunion. It's going to be really great. And for the rest of us, I probably have to hold back tears because it's going to be like seeing my old friends up there again. People I used to compete with, people that I read about and I interviewed years and years ago. It's going to be really nice.
The play.
Boyer Coe, 220 pounds, 5 feet 9 inches, Mr. America, 4-time Mr. Universe, and 7-time Mr. World. Originally from Rain, Louisiana, he now resides in Costa Mesa, California, and is the marketing director for a gym equipment company. At 48 years of age, Boyer believes he can defeat Lou and win the Masters Olympia title.
Well, that's it. Pull. Pull. That's it. Come
on. For me, it's something that I've always wanted to do. I mean, being big and strong goes as far back as I was 5 years old. I used to either buy the bodybuilding magazines when I had money, and when I didn't have money, I'd steal them from the grocery store and look at the pictures. And I remember it had to have been 5 years old because I couldn't read. All I could do was look at the pictures. But at that time, I wasn't at that time really clear that you used weights to build a big, strong body like that. I just knew that when I grew up, that's what I wanted to look like. I recall my grandfather had a barbershop, and I used to shine shoes in his barbershop, when I was 14, 15 years old. And I used to tell people who I'd be shining their shoes that I was gonna be Mr. America one day. And these guys would politely look down from their newspaper and nod their heads. And I'm sure they had no idea what the hell Mr. America even was, much less this skinny little kid in front shining her shoes was gonna be Mr. America. But I believed in myself. And I think a lot of that has to do from basically, everything that you do is a product of your environment, or you learn by example. And I think my parents instilled in me a very strong work ethic, and then a strong belief in myself. So I believe that anything I tackled and I continued to put forth effort in, I could accomplish it.
This is what separates the men from the boys. This dumbbell here. There's only one of them in here. Because one is all we need.
What is it?
That's a 200-pound one. I'm talking real big. I hope I can do it.
That's it.
With Brunson, he and I are about the same size, we're about the same strength level, and he, again, is very determined, has a high degree of intensity, puts everything in his workout. He pushes me, I push him. It's a friendly competition. I mean, many times, if it's just him and I in the gym, we can go through the whole workout, but probably not seeing more than, you know, how much weight you want on this exercise or something. In other words, because we're so in tune with working out.
The training part is exciting, guys.
The training is the best part. In other words, entering the Masters Miss Olympia, the motivation for me to do that is just to seeing how good I can get. And we're using all of these months of preparation to improve. In other words, if I can step on that stage at 48 and be better than I was, say, when he and I first met back in 1981, that's a huge accomplishment to me. Well, Louis's just a big guy. I mean, if Louis didn't have the height that he had, you know, which obviously makes him stand out, I don't think you'd even notice him. It's just the fact that he's so much taller and bigger than everybody else. And undoubtedly, he enjoys a great popularity because he was fortunate enough to be in that Hulk series, you know. He has a lot of press. But as far as being a bodybuilder that I say that I fear or that I am concerned about in competition, I'm not in the least. In other words, when he decided to more or less make a comeback and compete in a Mr. Olympia 2 years ago, who was the person he turned to for advice? Me. So I'm, in a sense, kind of like the father telling the son what to do. So this time it's like the father competing against the son. It's like the old bull competing, or the old lion competing against the young lion. Old lion never tells all the secrets.
London's classic rock FM96, closing out a 30-minute rock block with the tragically hip Small Town Bring Down. Brings us to 3:30 exactly, and a special treat actually going on in London. We talked about this a while ago. This is the day of the Western Ontario Bodybuilding Championship that goes on at 7 o'clock tonight at Centennial Hall. You are going to see world-class bodybuilders, and you're going to see somebody who we are actually fortunate enough to have in the studio at this very second. You may think of him as the Incredible Hulk, but Lou Ferrigno is actually his name, and he's here. Say hi.
Before I begin to say anything, every time I've done radio interviews, always when I see that this jockey, they look like farmers. It's so nice to look at a pretty woman like you that put me at ease. I could do a nice radio interview now, like, yeah, okay, testing 1, 2, 3, 4. So anyway, it's a pleasure to be here. And I'm looking forward tonight to the pose at the contest. I'm in the best shape of my life. I'm 295 pounds, 1% body fat. And the audience is going to just love it.
Now, who else is there? I was reading in the paper today, and we talked about this earlier, that you've been, after a 17-year absence, is what the paper said. Now, is this something you did as a youth? You did a lot of bodybuilding and have now come back to it, and what's...
I retired years ago when I took the film Pumping Iron with Arnold Schwarzenegger because it wasn't in me anymore. I went into show business. But it was always a part of me that wanted to compete again, to be on stage, to be in my best shape. So I decided to make a comeback again.
I'm sorry, I guess this is my downfall. I don't know a lot about bodybuilding. So this is a competition tonight?
Yes, it's a competition going on tonight, different weight classes, and I'm the guest poser. Tonight I'll have more fun than competition. They're going to see something tonight they've never seen in their life before.
Yeah, I mean the first I'm too sexy. The song, like it.
Yeah, you have to find the cue.
Yeah, no problem.
But like I said, the light's going to go on. Watch me. I'm going to do this. boom like this, mile 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, then push the button. So.
Okay, middleweight, we're waiting for you.
Let's all go. Ready over there? Okay, number 19, Chris Alcock.
I promise you that they'll be in the best shape of their life. But my whole goal is to come in and peak and be in my all-time best. That's why tonight is the perfect timing, so I could really get the feel of my condition with the audience. Because if you're very nervous and insecure by yourself on the day of the show, then you got problems, because I've been working very hard on my posing. I want to make sure everything is falls into place.
Unbelievable.
Every day I wake up, every day I improve, I better my life. You have to believe in yourself. This is the first time I believe in myself. So I could go on stage to be a champion. I was always holding back at that fear. You see, there are a lot of athletes today that could have been phenomenon. They never achieved that because they're afraid to let go of that fear. I wanted to break every fear that came along. Now, you know something? I've done it. Every single fear. Coming back, getting on stage again, G-string, whatever you call it, my best shape, my legs better than ever, 40 pounds heavier. I said, nothing's going to stop me. Nothing's going to be in the way. I mean, if my house comes down with an earthquake, nothing's going to stop me. Take into consideration is how do you feel about yourself on stage. The most important thing to me of all is my fan. The fan is everything. The fan is the one that makes me come back. The fan is the one that's going to be there young for me. That's the power that gives me the drive to do this, knowing I could get on stage, boom, 300 pounds, and the place is not going to come apart. It's the fans, it's not the judges, it's not the promoters, it's not the magazine, it's the fan. That's where it all comes down to.
A kid, you know, in the vicinity of 2-3 years old, he had a bunch of ear infections. No one knew anything was wrong until one day parents talked to him and he didn't respond. And from that time on, they realized there was something wrong with him. This was a real difficult time for Louis. His parents put a tremendous amount of pressure on him. The fact that he had to wear the huge hearing aid made it very uncomfortable for him and awkward, and the kids in Brooklyn were very cruel and had no sympathy for him and made it very, very difficult for him, which made him very insecure and had very low self-esteem at that particular time in his life.
I always got involved in reading comic books like the Hulk, Spider-Man, because I was always intrigued by the muscle. I used to watch Hercules on TV with Steve Reeves. I used to watch Superman, fantasizing that the big muscles would be a great defense for me, to protect me against my handicap. And then I got to the point that I one day discovered Joe Wheeler's muscle power, at the time, Muscle Fitness. And I realized that bodybuilder did it this, like Miss America. And subconsciously, without realizing, I knew that it was a thing for me to feel better about myself. Because when I was a young kid, they used to pick on me all the time. They used to pull my hearing aid out of my ear. They used to call me Deaf Louie, Deaf Mute. So I wanted to be strong enough and big enough that people will have respect for me. So then I took up bodybuilding. I was about 12 and a half, and I wasn't doing very well in school. They threatened to put me back one grade. So my father said to me, he says, okay, I'll make a deal with you. If you come home, you pass your grades, you keep the weights. If you don't, I'm going to throw everything out. Now, that to me, taking that away from me, is like taking everything from me. I found a way to make it through school. I knew it was hard to be in the classroom because I didn't want everybody to know that I have this hearing problem, this speech problem. I wanted to be perfect like everyone else. I cheated. I did everything I could to pass, come home with a passing report card so I can keep on training. I was just obsessed with it.
Weeder Enterprises, Woodland Hills, California.
Feel it. You gotta feel it to really get the size of it. Feel the bicep. You can't tell with the eye.
I believe you.
See, the cat looks better than me.
Joe Weeder, premier publisher of health and fitness magazines and founder of the Mr. Olympia competition. Joe is considered by many to be the father of bodybuilding.
Every kid has to look up to someone great. They don't have someone great ruling a sport or some great figure. You know, it doesn't have that same impact emotionally. And Lou Ferrigno, I thought following Arnold was great because he's big. He had natural potential. In fact, Arnold told me many times if I had Lou Ferrigno's genetics, he says, I would have been twice as good as I am today. The difference between him and Arnold was that Arnold had a will of iron. Lou also had a strong will, but not like Arnold. Lou vacillated more, because Lou was much more an emotional person, and Arnold was more plodding, mental, and so forth. And he decided after he competed in 1975, when they made Pumping Iron, that no way he was going to become anything. He'll never grow up. He'll never become an individual. He'll never be his own person as long as he lived with his father, because his father was very domineering. See, I took an interest in him, and I tried to understand him, what his problems were and so forth, and I supported him in everything, and I encouraged him. When he got a little depressed, I told him that he can do it and so forth. I kept building him up, you know, as I do with every bodybuilder, I keep building them up and encouraging them. And Lou made an attachment because he bonds easily with people. If he can only control his emotional makeup, he can carry through what he looks like just before the contest, in the contest, he would be great and win.
This gives me a goal, a drive, and a desire to get Louis the best he can ever possibly be, for him to win this show. And that's what I want, and I want him to win the show more than anything in the world.
Well, I gotta tell you, that was one of the things I really worried about this year when we started training for this thing. Because I said to him, okay, Louis, I'll train with you. But you can't throw weights, you can't have temper tantrums, you can't do that stuff that you used to do. I knew he was gonna be great. I mean, that was the one thing I knew. He had the drive and the determination. I mean, he worshipped Arnold. And the truth was, no matter how hard I pushed him, he would do it. He would train as hard as I would push him. He was not a quitter. He would really work his tail off, and I knew what he wanted to be. His goal was to be Mr. Olympia.
All day. You're doing the opposite with your best.
You're doing the opposite with your always. Your last one's always your worst. Today, your last one's always your best.
Do you want 10?
Yes.
Thank you.
Eddie Giuliani, manager of World Gym and longtime friend of Lou.
There's a, you know, if anybody loves bodybuilding, if you pick the top 10 guys that are in love with this bodybuilding game for longevity, the long time, the long span of it, he'd have to be way up there. You know, he's totally dedicated and in love with this. It's a part of his life, Louis, that never was fulfilled. If Louis wins or loses the Olympia, Louis will always be a champion. What he's doing now is fulfilling a dream. And the dream that he's fulfilling, it'll be fulfilled in Louis's eyes. But that's what he's doing. He's fulfilling a personal dream of himself. As far as the people go, Louis is, you know, another planet. And so Louis is a superstar right now. Louis will always be a champion.
Well, I think Lou is not, to me, he's big, but he's not symmetrical, you know. He's awesome, but if you really come down to body parts, it's just one good body part. I think it's his traps. That's it, you know. As far as Boyer, he has everything, you know. A little of this, a little of that. It's like a good all-around package.
That's why I never even worried too much about it.
If you want to talk about the best bodybuilders in the world, I will probably be, in one instance, go down in history as the best bodybuilder in the world because of one reason. I will outlast everybody. I've been doing this now going on 35 years. 35 years from now, if I'm alive, I'll still be doing this. I'll be training with the same enthusiasm simply because I love to train. Well, to me, like taking the Masters contest that's coming up, I don't care if the prize money is $25,000, $25, or 25 cents, or a blue ribbon. I'm just going there because the contest is only a measure, a yardstick for me to see if at 48 years old I can be better than I was ever before in my life. That's my motivation. And I don't care if I come out first or dead last in the contest. What I'm looking for is to accomplish that goal of being better than I've ever been before. And then you say, well, how do you gauge that? It's certainly not by the judges. I really don't care what the judges think of me, because once I step on the stage, I don't have any control of what the judges. All I can do is prepare myself best, the best I can. What I'm looking for is the people that I respect, who have known me all my life in this sport, who will tell me the truth and say, if that contest is over with and they say, hey, you know, you looked better than you've ever looked before, then that's the satisfaction I get out of it. But it's the total result that you get from being the best you can be. Because you got to look at it. A contest, a bodybuilding contest, is only a matter of an opinion of some other people, of you. Basically, what you're doing is standing up there almost totally naked saying, hey, I hope you like me better than the next guy. I like Louis, although I think Louis is a very frustrated individual. There is, and there probably always will be, a certain amount of resentment, from Louis towards Arnold because of the way the Pumping Iron movie kind of made Louis look. And I think now, you know, by instituting this Masters, he's looking for a win, because originally when they first started talking about this, the cutoff point was 45 years old and above. And I think that Louis had something to do with convincing Joe to lower the age to 40 so he would be allowed to enter, which is fine. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I don't give a damn who enters.
Hello? Yeah. Oh, Joe, we're okay.
at your home.
Must read my mind every time in the middle of training. Can't see what you want. You probably want to know how my progress is going. I'm working on my post. Hi, Joe. How you doing? What's happening? Well, I came out. I had no money. I received only, I think, $200 or $300 for the guest posting fee. I was so determined not to go home because I figured it was my only chance to stay in California. So I slept on the beach for 2 weeks. I had no money because, you know, food really adds up. I called Joe. I begged Joe. I said, Joe, please, I don't want to go home. Please give me a contract. I really want to stay here. I want to train for the Miss Olympia. I convinced him that I was not going to leave bodybuilding. So from that time on, I started to do posing exhibition to make California my home, like a dream coming true, because I know going home, I was not going to be a happy person. And Joe, I mean, saved my life.
Okay. All right, Joe, bye-bye.
Now, you see, when I brought him here, I thought at that time he would be able to pull himself together. And I worked with him, I encouraged him, and was preparing him to enter the Miss Olympia. And I believe that he would have won at that time because, you know, who he was competing against. They were not these great champions. They were not that heavily developed. His size, his muscularity was awesome. And if he trained a whole year, I was sure that he was going to win the Olympia and for a couple of years thereafter.
Back in the times in Brooklyn, I was a different person. I lied about my parents saying, I even thought I had perfect parents. I even thought I had the kind of family like you would see on Father Knows Best. It wasn't like that in my house. It was the opposite. I carry all her guilt and anger because he projected all the feelings on me because he had other friends who were policemen. They raved about their son. My son is in school. My son is doing this. He's getting this on the test. And then he would come home and say, look at my son, this and this. Which is sad, but I think the fact that he could not relate to me to having a handicap, so instead, he resented himself, probably hated himself, the fact that he had an imperfect son, that he did something wrong. So we have really no bond, no connection. Well, you know, the sad thing is, when I was the champion, I was the winner, I thought he loved me. He couldn't accept me losing. He only showed interest if there was ways of making money, for me getting attention, but he couldn't see his son losing. He can't accept defeat. You know, we had many incidents. I mean, it was like a love and hate relationship. Everything my father wanted to be, imagined to be, I've become. He said, if you had your hearing, you're going to be a great athlete. If you had your hearing, you'd be a popular like Arnold Schwarzenegger. If you had your hearing, you'd be doing this. He didn't have the self-esteem to do all this. I've done it. When I was born, I lost 85% of my hearing. I couldn't speak. I could not hear. I was very introverted. I decided to try bodybuilding. It gave me such a good feeling about myself. It made me feel strong because as a kid, they used to call me deaf mute. So I thought I was dumb, I was stupid because I didn't have my hearing. But when I started to lift weights, I said to myself, I'm gonna be so big, so strong someday, nobody's gonna pick on me. I guess I did a little, gone too far in that direction.
You know, you always see him on TV, but you never get the chance to see him in person.
This was your birthday present to come here to the show.
Yeah.
Yeah. To come see Lou or the show?
Lou.
Yeah. Lou, yeah.
Why come see Lou, though? Why Lou Ferrigno?
Big fan.
Well, he's like my idol.
Yeah. Idol.
Yeah.
So.
I like it. It's great, yeah.
Those arms are massive. Like, I mean, I sit there and look at my arms and I go, shit, look at the size of his arms.
Yeah, how big do you think his arms are?
His arms are even bigger. Like
how big his arms are?
Well, both of them.
Well, it says
bigger than
they're 23 and a half.
My arm and my butt.
Plus. Aren't they? 23 and a half plus?
Push more.
See, to me, one of the things that's the biggest problem today, I would think, with young kids is the fact that they don't have any goals. Now, my goal, granted, was an oddball goal to win the Mr. America contest. Now, I didn't really care how insignificant or how unimportant that was to somebody else. It was a goal for me. It was my goal. So that, I think, contributed a lot to me working towards something which kept me out of trouble in other aspects. At 17 years old, at 180 pounds, back in 1964, I had bench pressed over 400 pounds. And at that time, there wasn't too many kids 18 years old that could do that. So I developed very fast, and I matured as far as muscularity and so forth is concerned. So I won a Mr. America contest at 21. You have to understand something. I developed very fast. In other words, I was basically, I would say, very adapt or perfect for bodybuilding. My father was one who never had an opportunity to get involved in lifting weights, but he encouraged me. Actually, when I first started, he always was with me at all of the bodybuilding competitions I went to, and I traveled all over the South, you know, competing in the very beginning. And I would say that he never pushed me into it, and he never drove, because his primary importance was that I should place all my emphasis on education, but he never discouraged me from lifting weights.
What is? See, Louis thinks this is water. This is really a secret. This is vodka.
Well, Ira happened to be a member of R&J Health Club, but he had the kind of personality back then. He was a big sports fan. I think I was in the wrong business. I was, to me, it's like he shouldn't have been another Vince Lombardi. Anyway, I was training with Kenny Thompson back then. His wife got pregnant. He goes, listen, I can't train with you, but he's going to have a good training partner named Ira. You should try to train with him. He'll be great for you. So I went to the gym. I called him up. We met. We took our first workout. It was an arm workout. We finished the workout with dips. And he went like this. Great. From that day on, it was like two gears that just clicked perfect. It was magic.
When I first met Louis, or not met him, when we really started training together, we became instant friends. And it really kind of struck me that like Louis really didn't have very many, if any, friends, and the one or two that he did have, he wasn't really close to me. From the time we started training, it became me. He sort of lived in this sheltered life that his father put around him, and his world was bodybuilding. His whole thing, or one of his main things, was to go out to prove I can be the best at something. There's nothing wrong with me. I'm okay, and I'll do whatever it takes to prove that I'm okay and I'm a winner.
It has been really difficult raising a family and getting ready for this contest and helping Lou through it.
I never had any thoughts about what competition would be like to be involved in it with Lou. I had thought about his past and saw Pumping Iron and heard stories about bodybuilders who have done competitions. But I never had a clue as to what it would really be like. I didn't marry a bodybuilder. I married an actor.
My gut reaction to Lou saying to me, I'm going to do the Masters, was kind of an excitement, because I've lived with him all these years. I know what bodybuilding has meant to him. I know how people love him. I know how much they love him being a bodybuilder. So my initial reaction was, yes, you know, do it and fulfill your dreams. Do what you gotta do.
But when it was said and done, I hadn't bargained for all that it would take, all the selfishness, all the raising the children by myself, being an only parent, because that's really what I was. I mean, I was an only parent to these kids. When it came to bodybuilding, I was out of the picture, completely out of the picture. I didn't do the food. I didn't do the posing stuff with him. I couldn't train with him. I couldn't do anything with him as far as that went. Or did I want to? I cared that he would get to achieve something that he'd always dreamed of. I cared about that. I cared about how he felt about it. But I didn't care about the reality of every day, the posing, the food, the diet, the stress from it. But this, I just removed myself from. It was too hard.
I'll tell you one thing. I predict that Lou Ferrigno's going to win. But like I told Louis, it's not going to be a cakewalk. It's going to be a fight. It's going to be a battle. He's going to have some top, top guys, some legends. He better have his posing down. He better have his definition in there perfect. He better have as much size as he possibly can, because those are guys who are going to be battling him tooth and nail. These are the masters.
My belief is that if you want to compete in a world championship competition like the Mr. Olympia, that you don't have to get your mind together. Because you have the mind together, you have the will, and you have the motivation and the drive and the vision to see yourself as the winner or forget about the whole thing. It's you have it in you that you're meant to win this contest, then that faith in yourself and that vision that you have of winning, that is what will carry you there. That is what will take you through the hours and hours of working out, through the pounds and tons of lifting weights. But if you have to first get your act together and first have to set your mind, that means that you didn't have it.
I just think he's just all around better. It bothers me when they say Louis just big, because Louis, for a guy 6'5", there's never been a bodybuilder that tall who has shape, symmetry, proportion, a great set of abdominals, great arms, chest, back. Louis has it all.
It's a matter of life or death. My goal is, and our goal is for me to be on stage and say, hey, we can't do anymore. I do not intend to be in the Master Olympia for 4 or 5 years. It's like one time, I want to come like in King Kong and be in the best shape. Lou Ferrigno is in a very comfortable position right now. He has a wonderful family. He has an incredible wife. He has lovely children. He makes money. He lives in a wonderful house. It's all comfortable. And therefore, that makes it the biggest obstacle to compete in a Mr. Olympia or in any sports competition as far as it goes. You've got to be hungry, and there ought to be no safety net there. And that is when you become the most fierce in competing and the most fierce of a competitor.
You can't help but be drawn to the largest individual on stage, and he, I mean, overshadows everybody by far, simply because of the height and the size that he is. I don't think the quality of his physique is outstanding as his sheer height and size. I'm going there to do my absolute best. I can't control the outcome. I mean, if I could, I'd say, yeah, I'm going to win. But I'd be foolish in telling you that, because I can't control the judge's mind. I will tell you this much. I'll be the best that I can be on that particular day.
Boyer Cohen, these guys have said, look, he says, remember when we competed, there was no money in it at all. And we did it for the fun of the sport, so that's why we're doing it now. And I think that's it with Louis. Louis's got something to prove to himself. Louis came within a hair of winning the Mr. Olympia contest, and Louis needs a Mr. Olympia contest. In a sense, it makes you immortal. It puts you in history. It makes you an important part of bodybuilding history. And if you drop dead the next day, you live forever in the annals of bodybuilding history. It makes you immortal.
Morning.
Hi, Louis.
Is Mr. Dr. Weiss here?
Yeah,
thanks. Oh, boy.
Hey, Lou.
How you doing?
Right with you.
Getting down to the wire. Got a few more weeks.
Yeah, I know. Getting close, man.
Well, we got to look on the hip. It's just like, leaving like this, you know?
Well, you're on schedule, buddy. Come on.
Okay.
Go all the way to the back, on the left. Seen anybody else? No, all the way in the back on the left.
No, I haven't been able to see anybody, but I just know everybody's been training hard. I don't know why the last couple of days
A lot of these top-level bodybuilders are just crazy. They really push themselves to the point of overtraining almost all the time.
Shooting pain here.
You know, bodybuilding's a mentality all to its own, especially at that top level. There's quite a number of injuries. You know, they're pushing their bodies to the absolute limits.
Well, we'll fix you up.
These guys, they want to win, you know. Unfortunately, top level athletics, you know, in the country, in almost every field, is not that healthy. They push themselves to win no matter what happens to their body. He loses one of the biggest, he's one of the thickest. He's really hard to adjust, you know, especially his lower back. I sent him for some x-rays and they had a tough time getting the x-rays through him because he's so thick and it's all muscle. You know, they figured out the factors it would take to x-ray somebody his size, and it didn't work. They had to, like, triple it because somebody his size is usually fat. He's 310 pounds of muscle. So, yeah, it's definitely a challenge to work on Luke. Just relax, man. Just relax, man. Just relax.
Did you ever think there'd come a time where all you guys would be getting back together almost 20 years later, on stage?
I never could conceive of something like this, of being the Masters Mr. Olympia. And as soon as that opportunity came, I remember Jerry Branham called me on the phone and says, Bill, it's coming, it's going to happen. I said, who do I call? I got to find out. I found out in April, and I mean, I was already training, but I mean, the intensity of my training stepped up. I mean, just to be back with the boys again, I mean, here it is, Ed Corney, man, Mike Katz.
I think what's going to be kind of nice is that...
Mike Katz, a former Mr. Universe who is presently an IFBB official scheduled to judge tomorrow's competition.
You know, stadium with guys that can hardly run to first base. I mean, that's not what we're going to see.
We're going to see some
quality. You're going to see some great athletes that would be in the top 10 in the Mr. Olympia the following day. So this is not, you know, we're just getting together some gray-haired or no-haired guys, you know, I mean, once you meet it. I mean, there's a great group of athletes, and I think what's going to happen is not only is a younger audience who never saw this other than in Pumping Iron, or maybe have heard about it from their dad, you know what I mean, from years ago, or saw the old magazines, now they're going to see it, you know, live, in person.
Play the music, and then I will walk out, because the intro is me walking on.
Go all the way to the end of the routine. Yes. And your room number is
1006.
Everybody knows now.
Well, I feel very confident. In other words, if I was trying to come back after a 10-year layoff, then I would feel more anxiety. But I mean, as I said earlier in the press conference, I haven't changed anything in the last 10 years. I've trained just as hard as I would if I would have been competing. So I didn't really have to do anything special to get in shape for this contest. And one of the things that I feel very good about is after training some 34 years and doing a lot of things right, a lot of things wrong, I believe at 48, and I hope to prove that tomorrow, that this is the best shape I've ever been in my life.
God forbid, I'm hoping I don't control a blank when
Bill
I get up.
Bill Grant, 45 years old, 225 pounds, 6 feet tall, a Mr. America and Mr. World who came out of retirement to compete in tomorrow's event.
You kind of miss it when you're not there. You miss that crowd roaring, and when you're on that stage, I mean, it's just you. Everybody's focused in on you, and you feel great when you hear that noise and you get that adulation. And you walk off stage and it's like, wow, here I am again.
Go ahead. You just
come out.
Okay.
All right. Good. Flex. Okay. There you go.
When you were a little
kid that you want to be Mickey Mantle or Willie Mays. I say I come from New York, so I wanted to be Mickey Mantle. So I dreamt when I was 10 years old about walking in center field, you know, in Yankee Stadium by the monuments. Louis was not a big avid sports fan. Louis' thing from a real early age was bodybuilding, and it was Larry Scott when Louis was 15 years old. And that was his driving force. He wanted to be Mr. Olympia, and the fact that he was never able to get it because of the way life's twists and turns happen was why he wanted this much this year.
That's awesome. That's perfect.
That's it, man.
All right, keep that up.
All right. All right.
For Lou to feel complete, I think that winning would really do it. For about an hour. You know, if you're asking me that question, I think he already is complete. But he doesn't really know it yet. He thinks that this competition is what will make him the ultimate complete man. And I think, you know, I don't want to miss sight of who he is. It's kind of a selfish answer, because I've never been there. I haven't walked in his shoes in this area. And I think that, yes, it would be a great completion for his life to have that, truly. I think he would eventually see that it wasn't the answer to all of his happiness or unhappiness. But I think it would be a great feather in his cap.
I'm really excited that you're having the first ever Masters Olympian. You know, as each day goes by, I'm getting more excited.
Lonnie Tepper, renowned bodybuilding journalist and sports commentator.
We're talking about almost 20 years ago, and you had a young guy like Lou Ferrigno, 24 years old. I think he was 256, 258 pounds. I did an interview with the guy a month ago. He's 298 pounds, veins all over the place, his abs are in. And in my column, I predict Robbie Robinson to win this show, but I'm starting to think, you know what, LT? You maybe have made a mistake, a very big mistake, because that's one huge monster there. And I think of Lou Ferrigno as the Hulk on TV, this big green monster coming out of your screen into your living room, and now he's going to be coming out of the posing day right into my seat in the front row. I can't wait.
It's like all camaraderie. The whole gang coming together, participating in an event, reliving a lot of the past. It's really great to see all the fellas again, and I'm anxious to see what they look like and what they have accomplished.
All right, Boyer, here. Bernard Salet, here. Chris Dickerson, here. Lou Ferrigno's here.
Yes.
Herman Hoffman, here. Olaf Ross, here. Danny Padilla, here.
Louis was ready. Louis was as ready as one human being could be for a contest. And I know that we've done everything in my mind, in my heart, in his mind, in his heart, to do everything we could to have him be the best he could possibly be to win the show, which I truly believe he will do.
Professional competition is judged in the afternoon before the night show finals. This round of judging establishes the placement of each competitor on a three-round point system. Judges look for symmetry, proportion, and muscular separation. This phase of competition is called the pre-judging.
Rear double bicep.
The show is basically won or lost at the pre-judging. That takes place in the afternoon, and that's when the judges bring all of the contenders out on stage. They get to see the whole lot, and then they can pair them up against each other. For example, doing quarter turns, doing front double biceps, doing side chest, doing all the mandatory poses. You want to see them next to each other because everybody looks great standing by themselves. What the pre-judging does is it lets you see them not only by themselves, but then it allows the judges to compare the top people against each other.
Side chest.
Look, just incredible.
Front double bicep.
Here you go, the biceps.
His chest looks great, though, too.
Yep, there it is.
Yep.
Boom. Look at the peaks on those biceps.
Look at his vacuum. I mean, look at his waist.
Robbie Robinson, 210 pounds, 5 feet 9 inches, 48 years old. A surprise entry who has come from Oslo, Norway, to compete in this year's competition. Robbie believes he can beat Lou and Boyer for the overall title.
Look how small his waist is in the back.
Which gets his lat spread and then comes out the rear double bicep. That's still, to me, right here. Look at that. Bam. Look at those biceps.
Right on.
Jeez.
Look at his glutes.
Unbelievable.
Everything's pretty tight.
Watch when he works that bicep, watch it split.
I know, he does got those freaky biceps, don't he?
I know, Vinicius and him and Robbie next to each other.
Rear double bicep.
Look at his legs. I mean, he's got veins in his legs, his calves.
Everywhere.
Yeah.
Look at that. He does, he's got them. He's got great arms. He's got good triceps and biceps.
Leg spread.
You know, in general, you're always trying to bring up every area. So in other words, I've never really viewed one area, in my particular instance, as outstanding or one that's, in other words, I've always trying to bring everything up. I've never been satisfied with the way my arms look or my legs or back or anything. You just continue to work, you know, to bring everything up. And that's what I've constantly did over, you know, how the last 10 or since I've started working out, the last 30 years of working out. In other words, that's what's kept me going, is the curiosity just to see how good I can be. No, I've never really been satisfied with anything. I always say, well, I feel I can always be a little bit better. I got a little more potential. Let me push the envelope a little bit further. So I'm still trying to get better.
He's got those 23-inch plus arms. It's enormous. Yeah.
You know, his back looks really good.
Yeah.
He's in really good shape, this show.
Rear double bicep.
You've got to be totally focused. You know, you can have all the goods, but if you don't have your mindset on and ready to do battle, more or less, against everybody else, then you're pretty much defeated.
Troy Zuccolato, IFBB professional bodybuilder.
I think it's psychologically, you prepare yourself more like a football player or a basketball player. The same as goes through bodybuilding. If you can have the physique, but if you don't mentally have it to go up there and stand in the prejudging tensed all the time where you get drained, I mean, to stand there flexed through a whole prejudging would last about 2 hours, you're physically drained. So if you're not mentally prepared and physically prepared, like in football, you can be defeated before you even step on stage. What I've seen today, it depends on the judging. I think they all have come in incredible shape, better than I've ever seen any of them. I think if you're judging on symmetry, I think Robbie is the best as far as symmetry goes. If you're looking at overall freakness, size, shape, just monster, then you got to give it to Lou Ferrigno. If you're going for hardness, what kind of condition a bodybuilder is in, then you got to give it to Boyer.
Thank you, gentlemen. That concludes round two.
So really, all three of them could win this show. It just depends on what type of judging, what type they're looking for today.
I think everything went fine. The only thing that perhaps I was just a little bit
aggravated with was the fact that the tan stuff I had when I started to sweat ran a little bit, but I mean, that's a minor thing, you know, I mean, I saw other guys having the same problem, so it's not something that was only only involved with just myself, so it's not anything big. No, I didn't have any cramps, or I didn't shake, or, you know, it's not any anxiety going on stage. I mean, it's like I mentioned earlier, once it's kind of like riding a bicycle, once you do it, you don't forget how to do it, you know.
You streaked all over the
over here, and your
look
back.
Look at the chest here.
We gotta get all that shit off.
We got time to work on it. 2 hours.
Why are you sweating, buddy? What are
you doing, huh?
I'm sweating.
You're the cattleman.
You know, it's streaky. And Luke, when you turned around, you can see the blotches running in. See? You see, it's all blotched.
Are you going to get pictures?
Lynn, how do we get back to the hotel?
There's a shuttle on here.
There's a shuttle. No, after you went back out, you know, and you got that stuff wiped off and the oil put on and you came out for the second round, I thought you looked much, much better. And then by the third round, you looked by far less. Louis, here, I got your wallet.
They better not give it to somebody else.
The one thing I think that was always the same for me seeing Lou was that I know him so well, and I know the kind of tenacity that he has. He has the quality that I admire so much in another person, that he is a champion. You know, he has a champion mentality. I am the opposite of him. I am a woman who started out very young doing 5 million things, and I can do them all really well. But I've never focused on one thing, blocking out all the rest, and me becoming a true champion that can win, you know, all these great awards. I never did that. I do all the other things that make me happy. Him, he had one direction, and that's what I see in champions in all areas, is that quality. To blank it all out, do the one thing they love, and be the best in the world at it.
The competition is in progress, and the judges have cut the field to 5 for the final pose down.
Today you have guys competing there where you know from the first minute when you see them on stage that they're never going to win, nor do they believe they're going to win. They should have another contest, have a loser's contest or something like that, but not in this competition. This competition, it's winning, it's beating, it's destroying the other people, and that's it. You should be standing out there as the victor on top of the pedestal, get this gold medal around it, get this trophy, take the $100,000 and go home and say, I was the best. That's what it's all about. If you want to do something else, then you have to do something else. Run a gym, train people, or do something else. But I mean, don't go in the Olympia.
My whole life I've carried this suit of armor, this 300-pound suit of armor, because it was my protection. I come to the realization that people love Lou for me, for who I am, not because I'm the 300-pound Hulk with a 300-pound bodybuilder. The title was not the answer to my happiness. You don't have to really have a trophy or be on stage and be a champion to make yourself feel like a better person, be happy. It's how you feel about yourself. You do the best you can. Like I've always thought my whole life, being a world champion will make me the person I want to be, that everybody loves me, that everybody does love me, people respect me. But the title did nothing to change that. Will make me a better person.
I don't know anyone on the level of world championship competition, if it is in soccer, or if it's in skiing, in ice skating, or in bodybuilding, that would just love to go into a world championship competition, into the Olympics, into a Mr. Olympia competition, just for the joy of competing. It is utter nonsense if anyone thinks that he can then win or that he can really show his best. The idea of competing is always that you show the best that you can be, and that that can match up against anyone, and that you could beat anyone on your best day. That's why you go to compete. The idea of competing is that you want to show the world that you're number one.
We'll take that award to the third place finisher in a very close contest. To Boyer Cove. In second place, receiving the silver Sandow medal, being presented by Richard Pizarro of Weider Foods. You'll take the second place silver medal and give it to Lou Ferrigno.
First of all, I'd like to thank Joe Weider for inviting me over, Wayne DeMayer, Chris Stallone, the photographer. I also like to thank Jerry Fredericks for taking a lot of pictures and promoting me and pushing me.
He really worked his head off. He was in the best shape of his life. And there was nothing more in my mind, in my heart, that I know he could have done to look the way he did tonight for this show.
I had boys who were upset.
Yeah, and yeah.
Boy
was there, and the audience thought the same thing. The audience thought Boy had second, and I don't disagree with that. I just don't understand it. I don't know what you want.
Nobody knows more the disappointment after seeing the movie Pumping Iron with me in it. Every time, even that I see the movie today, my heart drops a little and I'm hurt by it. So I really understand where Louis is coming from, talking with him after the competition with his disappointment. And it disappoints me because I've been there and I understand what his family went through, what he went through to compete, and what effort it took. Louis gave it the best that he could give. And Robbie Robinson may have had an advantage in the competition, because when you look at Robbie's career, Robbie has not stopped. Robbie started at 18 years old, Robbie's 47, and Robbie Robinson has been competing over 30 years. And he's never out of condition, and he's never retired. So if anybody possibly had the edge, because Boyer had retired and Louis had retired for a long time and made attempts to come back and has looked terrific, probably the person who would have had the biggest advantage to win, if any of them, it would have been Robbie. And Robbie looked a little bit more separated, possibly. Obviously, nobody in the world's as big as Louis. And as far as I'm concerned, which I told Louis, whether he wins the over 40 10 times, it will never magnify his name as one of the true legends of the sport. I compare him to Babe Ruth and Lou Gehrig. I compare him to Johnny Unitas. I compare him to Jack Nicklaus, depending upon the sport that you're looking at. Louis is Louis. You don't ever have to say Louis who. When you say Big Mike, most people think of me. When it's Arnold, it's Schwarzenegger. When it's Big Louis, it's Lou Ferrigno. He doesn't have to prove anything to anybody. Louis Ferrigno is one of the most respected and loved bodybuilders and one of the truly great bodybuilders of all time, whether he was second, whether he was third, whether he won, whether he didn't. So my hats go off to him. He's one of the most loved and respected men that I've ever known, and he will always be a winner with me and with the rest of the world of bodybuilding.
Dodger Stadium, Los Angeles, California.
Two swings, right?
Billy, for us open now. A couple over here.
Right here?
Come on here.
There you go.
Lou, Billy. Lou, Billy.
Lou, right here. Lou, right here. Lou, right here.
Lou, Billy.
Lou.
Lou.
Lou, right here, please.
Hey.
Look down.
I think we're up at bat.
Lou has decided against competing in this year's Masters Olympia and plans to make official his retirement from bodybuilding at a special guest posing engagement in Columbus, Ohio.
I've heard this before. I've heard bodybuilding's over, I'm through, I'm done, and I'm not sure. I think if life circumstances were different than they are, if anything, I don't know what. I don't know what could change it, but I have a feeling that something in life could change that for him. I'm not sure it's out of his heart and soul, even though I know in his head he thinks it is. I don't know. He says it is, and for now, we're going to have to wait and see.
It may sound silly, but it's true, because when I was very young, as a matter of fact, my whole life, I've always thought that the answer to all my problems, happiness, internally, would be Mr. Olympia. Most people say they competed, like for example, some other bodybuilders, they say it was a job. I didn't go with the attitude, it's a job. I really competed because I wanted to be the world champion again. And this is something I want to do for me, to fulfill that need I was craving for all these years, to be the best of the best. I realized, like today, that it really didn't matter because I have so much in my life. I have my family, my wife, my children, my friend. They still love me the same. They still like me the same. This title is not going to change my relationship with them. And the most beautiful part of the whole thing is that very frustrated, scared, sad little boy, I've let him go. The shield of armor came off. I'm a very happy man today with myself. Titles don't mean nothing. It's what you have in your life. It's the old saying, you have what you have. All you can do is maximize what you got. If you compete with yourself and appreciate what you have, you got everything. If you try to be like someone else, like I wanted to be Mr. Olympia, I didn't win the title, there's no shame to it.
And he's huge!
Thank you, everybody. I want to say tonight officially, I have retired from bodybuilding, and tonight is my last pose in the exhibition because it's time for me to move on, to do appearances, go back to show business. But I want to say that thank you very much for making who I am today. My love to you, especially all my fans. And I promise I will continue bodybuilding for the rest of my life. But thank you so much for having me here tonight. And it brings a little sadness to me, but goodbye and thank you very much. It's been a pleasure. I love you all.
There may be a lot of injustice in bodybuilding. It's a very subjective sport. But what I've learned from this experience is that you get so focused on training for competition, you forget everything. But what it really taught me that after I got second place and went back to my hotel room, my wife was in the hallway. I heard a knock on the door. The door opened slowly with my two boys and my daughter. They came up to me. They said, Daddy, you're the greatest. Placing titles don't mean anything. It's what you are inside that makes a champion. It's that you say, I did it. I'm better and better, and nothing can stop you.
Bodybuilding contests will always come and go. Whether Louis wins a contest or not is not going to affect his fame whatsoever. And I think as far as Louis is concerned, and you must remember now, I've known Louis for 24 years, met him when he was only 19 years old. Louis will always stand tall, whether he wins a contest or not. As far as myself, I'll just try harder the next year, come back better than ever.
1975, he should not have stopped. He should have continued training the entire year, stayed at the body weight where he was at the Olympia, trained and trained and trained 4 hours a day. He would have beaten, you know, anyone in 1976, and he would have beaten anyone in 1977 all the way up to 1980, and who knows how much longer. If he would have continued training the way I was talking about, there would have been no one in the world that would have been as good as he was, and there would have been no one around in the future that would have been as good as he was.
World Gym, Venice, California, a popular hub where many professional athletes and bodybuilders come to train.
Better shoes on.
I should have had the lifts.
Well, I should have had the pump.
Well,
how you doing?
Getting ready for the match for Olympia.
Really?
Yeah,
so how much longer do you have to go?
I'll say about 4.5-5 months now.
It had to happen. You couldn't just put a guy over 40 out to pasture. Not in this sport. In this sport, you can't do it because guys got better after 40. Louis looks better today when he competed the last time than he did when he competed in his so-called heyday in Europe when he won the universe. Definitely, he's better today. So we didn't see his full potential when he was in his early 20s or in the late 20s. We've seen it now. Imagine we had to wait all this time to see his full potential, the way he blocked, late bloomer.
Couple of long sets.
What are we doing, shoulders?
Shoulders and arms. Okay, it's two long sets.
What do you want to do? Just get doing it.
Come on, stay with it. Get up. Easy. Come on. Again. Good. Come on. Up. Go. These two. Four more. Come on. Okay. All right. Down slow. All right. Two more. Go up.
Two more.
Do what you do. I didn't do nothing. One more.
Fight it. Way
up. Fight it. Down slow. Yeah. I got it. Now. Up, stretch the body. Up, and down, good. Come on, stay with it. Easy, easy kick. Lock it down. Come on. Good. One more. Come on. Get one more. Lock it up. Finish it.
Good.
Lou Ferrigno, 43 years old, 310 pounds, 6 feet 5 inches, making Lou the largest bodybuilder to have ever competed. Assisted by his best friend Ira Bankowski, Lou has emerged from a 19-year retirement to compete in this year's Masters Olympia.
The main reason why I came back is because I didn't want people to think I was a has-been. I really want to turn this into my ultimate dream to be a world champion again after over the age of 40, because I never won Mr. Olympia and I want to be the best. The reason why people want to be Mr. Olympia because they want to say, I am the best built man on the planet, the world, the best of the best. There's only one Mr. Olympia. You can be Mr. Universe, you can be Mr. America, you can win the national. But Mr. Olympia means you are number one.
Let's go. 10 good ones. Hold it. There you go. Everyone just like that. Yeah. Hold it.
Good.
Hold it.
The Masters Olympia is really the Super Bowl of professional bodybuilding. It was an idea that Joe Weider had thought about for a really long time, and it was to bring back all these former greats who had been in a previous Olympia. And what it was to get all these all-time greats that many of the people remembered going back as much as 20 or 25 years to get them on stage again.
It's a long one. Two.
Well, I think that I can totally understand if anyone wants to come back and compete in the Mr. Olympia competition. It is just a very...
Arnold Schwarzenegger, 7-time Mr. Olympia.
To come back out of retirement and to get back into the swing again and to get that momentum going and the rhythm going of training and to create the hunger, which is the most important thing, to create the will and the hunger to train 4 or 5 hours a day and to be that competitive when you get to the competition, that you would do anything possible. No matter how much posing you have to do, or how much training you have to do, or how much dieting you have to do, you will do it. That is the kind of will and hunger that you need.
Go! Come on. Up. Excellent. Good. Hold it at the top.
If you fall short by 5%, you're going to lose the competition. So that's the most dangerous thing to do, is to go back and maybe not create that hunger and that will anymore. And I think that is the obstacle that Lou Ferrigno has to overcome.
Important thing is, on stage, you want to be in the best shape, but everything is in the mind. So I felt that what Ira and I put together, no one knows better than the two of us. But I put myself in a position, okay, I'm not going to fight with you for the contest. You see, I really need something to do, tell me. Because in the past, I would fight with him because I want to make sure to be a winner. I have to maximize every body part. I would pose for him after every workout. He would check my clock list. But the most important thing is this time compared to years ago is the mind. Putting the mind into it that nothing's going to stop us. If you got pain, you work around the pain, you wrap it, you ice it, you got to do it.
Then the pre-judging saying in there, you have that folding.
It looks fine. It looks very good. I like it. A little bit more of a line, a little bit more separation. All right, come on, Dean. That's it. Let's go.
Chris, I think it's a real exciting contest. I know that I'm just really anxious to go see it. I was originally invited.
Don Ross, bodybuilding journalist.
They said that Wayne D'Amelio said he wants to keep it to just former Olympia contenders. Or people that have been in the Olympia. So what we're going to see now is people that you've read about for years and years in magazines. For the competitors themselves, it's going to be like a high school reunion. It's going to be really great. And for the rest of us, I probably have to hold back tears because it's going to be like seeing my old friends up there again. People I used to compete with, people that I read about and I interviewed years and years ago. It's going to be really nice.
The play.
Boyer Coe, 220 pounds, 5 feet 9 inches, Mr. America, 4-time Mr. Universe, and 7-time Mr. World. Originally from Rain, Louisiana, he now resides in Costa Mesa, California, and is the marketing director for a gym equipment company. At 48 years of age, Boyer believes he can defeat Lou and win the Masters Olympia title.
I said, pull. I said,
for me, it's something that I've always wanted to do. I mean, being big and strong goes as far back as I was 5 years old. I used to either buy the bodybuilding magazines when I had money, and when I didn't have money, I'd steal them from the grocery store and look at the pictures. And I remember it had to have been 5 years old because I couldn't read. All I could do was look at the pictures. But at that time, I wasn't at that time really clear that you used weights to build a big, strong body like that. I just knew that when I grew up, that's what I wanted to look like. I recall my grandfather had a barbershop, and I used to shine shoes in his barbershop, when I was 14, 15 years old. And I used to tell people who I'd be shining their shoes that I was going to be Mr. America one day. And these guys would politely look down from their newspaper and nod their heads. And I'm sure they had no idea what the hell Mr. America even was, much less this skinny little kid in front shining her shoes was going to be Mr. America. But I believed in myself. And I think a lot of that has to do from basically everything that you do is a product of your environment, or you learn by example. And I think my parents instilled in me a very strong work ethic, and then a strong belief in myself. So I believe that anything I tackled and I continued to put forth effort in, I could accomplish it.
This is what separates the men from the boys. There's no male here. There's only one of them in here. Because the one is all we need.
Where is it?
That's a 200-pound one. I'm talking real big. I hope I can do it. Come on.
That's it.
With Brunson, he and I are about the same size, we're about the same strength level, and he, again, is very determined, has a high degree of intensity, puts everything in his workout. He pushes me, I push him. It's a friendly competition. I mean, many times, if it's just him and I in the gym, we can go through the whole workout, but probably not seeing more than, you know, how much weight you want on this exercise or something. In other words, because we're so in tune with working out.
The training part is exciting, guys.
The training is the best part. In other words, entering the Masters Miss Olympia, the motivation for me to do that is just to see how good I can get. And we're using all of these months of preparation to improve. In other words, if I can step on that stage at 48 and be better than I was, say, when he and I first met back in 1981, that's a huge accomplishment to me.
What about
Well, Louis's just a big guy. I mean, if Louis didn't have the height that he had, you know, which obviously makes him stand out, I don't think you'd even notice him. It's just the fact that he's so much taller and bigger than everybody else. And undoubtedly, he enjoys a great popularity because he was fortunate enough to be in that Hulk series, you know. He has a lot of press, but as far as being a bodybuilder that I say that I fear or that I am concerned about in competition, I'm not in the least. In other words, when he decided to more or less make a comeback and compete in a Mr. Olympia 2 years ago, who was the person he turned to for advice? Me. So I'm, in a sense, kind of like the father telling the son what to do. So this time it's like the father competing against the son. It's like the old bull competing, or the old lion competing against the young lion. Old lion never tells all the secrets.
London's classic rock FM 96, closing out a 30-minute rock block with the tragically hip Small Town Bring Down. Brings us to 3:30 exactly, and a special treat actually going on in London. We talked about this a while ago. This is the day of the Western Ontario Bodybuilding Championship that goes on at 7 o'clock tonight at Centennial Hall. You are going to see world-class bodybuilders, and you're going to see somebody who we are actually fortunate enough to have in the studio at this very second. You may think of him as the Incredible Hulk, but Lou Ferrigno is actually his name, and he's here. Say hi.
Before I begin to say anything, every time I've done radio interviews, always when I see the disc jockey, they look like farmers. It's so nice to look at a pretty woman like you that put me at ease. I could do a nice radio interview now, like, yeah, okay, testing 1, 2, 3, 4. So anyway, it's a pleasure to be here. And I'm looking forward tonight to the close of the contest. I'm in the best shape of my life. I'm 295 pounds, 1% body fat. And the audience is going to just love it.
Now, who else is there? I was reading in the paper today, and we talked about this earlier, that you've been after a 17-year absence, is what the paper said. Now, is this something you did as a youth? You did a lot of bodybuilding and have now come back to it, and what's up with
that? I retired years ago when I did the film Pumping Iron with Arnold Schwarzenegger because it wasn't in me anymore. I went into show business. But it was always a part of me that wanted to compete again, to be on stage, to be in my best shape. So I decided to make a comeback again.
I'm sorry, I guess this is my downfall. I don't know a lot about bodybuilding. So this is a competition tonight?
Yes, it's a competition going on tonight, different weight classes, and I'm the guest poser. Tonight I'll have more fun than competition. They're going to see something tonight they've never seen in their life before.
Yeah, I mean, the first I'm too sexy. On the song, like it.
Yeah, you have to find the cue.
Yeah, no problem.
But like I said, the light's going to go on. Watch me. I'm going to do this.
boom, like this mile, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, then push the button. So.
Middleweight, men.
Okay, middleweight, we're waiting for you.
Y'all ready over there? Okay, number 19, Chris
Alcock. I promise you that they'll be in the best shape of their life. But my whole goal is to come in and peak and be in my all-time best. That's why tonight is the perfect timing, so I could really get the feel of my condition with the audience. Because you're very nervous and insecure by yourself. On the day of the show, then you got problems because I've been working very hard on my posing. I want to make sure everything is falling into place.
Unbelievable.
Every day I wake up, every day I improve, I better my life. You have to believe in yourself. This is the first time I believe in myself so I can go on stage to be a champion. I was always holding back at that fear. You see, there are a lot of athletes today that could have been phenomenon. They never achieved that because they're afraid to let go of that fear. I wanted to break every fear that came along. Now, you know something? I've done it. Every single fear. Coming back, getting on stage again, G-string, whatever you call it, my best shape, my legs better than ever, 40 pounds heavier. I said, nothing's gonna stop me. Nothing's gonna be in the way. I mean, if my house come down with an earthquake, nothing's gonna stop me. Take into consideration is how do you feel about yourself on stage. The most important thing to me of all is my fan. The fan is everything. The fan is the one that makes me come back. The fan is the one that's going to be there young for me. That's the power that gives me the drive to do this, knowing I can get on stage, boom, 300 pounds, and the place is not going to come apart. It's the fans, it's not the judges, it's not the promoters, it's not the magazine, it's the fan. That's where it all comes down to.
When Louis was a kid, you know, in the vicinity of 2-3 years old, he had a bunch of ear infections. No one knew anything was wrong until one day parents talked to him and he didn't respond. And from that time on, they realized there was something wrong with him. This was a real difficult time for Louis. His parents put a tremendous amount of pressure on him. The fact that he had to wear the huge hearing aid made it very uncomfortable for him and awkward. And the kids in Brooklyn were very cruel and had no sympathy for him and made it very, very difficult for him, which made him very insecure and had very low self-esteem at that particular time in his life.
I always got involved in reading comic books like the Hulk, Spider-Man, because I was always intrigued by the muscle. I used to watch Hercules on TV, receive reads. I used to watch Superman, fantasizing that the big muscles would be a great defense for me, to protect me against my handicap. And then I got to the point that I one day discovered Joe Weider's muscle power, at the time, Muscle Fitness. And I realized that bodybuilders did exist, like Miss America. And subconsciously, without realizing, I knew that it was a thing for me to feel better about myself. Because when I was a young kid, they used to pick on me all the time. They used to pull my hearing aid out of my ear. They used to call me Deaf Louie, Deaf Mute. So I wanted to be strong enough and big enough
that people will have respect for me. So then I took up bodybuilding. I was about 12 and a half, and1975, he should not have stopped. He should have continued training the entire year, stayed at the body weight where he was at the Olympia, trained and trained and trained 4 hours a day. He would have beaten, you know, anyone in 1976, and he would have beaten anyone in 1977 all the way up to 1980, and who knows how much longer. If he would have continued training the way I was talking about, there would have been no one in the world that would have been as good as he was. And there would have been no one around in the future that would have been as good as he was.
World Gym, Venice, California, a popular hub where many professional athletes and bodybuilders come to train.
Better shoes on.
I should have had the lifts.
Well, I should have had the pump.
Well.
How you doing?
Getting ready for the match with Olympia.
Really?
Yeah,
so how much longer do you have to go?
I'll say about 4.5-5 months now.
It had to happen. You couldn't just put a guy over 40 out the pasture. Not in this sport. In this sport, you can't do it because guys got better after 40. Louis looks better today when he competed the last time than he did when he competed in his so-called heyday in Europe when he won the universe. Definitely, he's better today. So we didn't see his full potential when he was in his early 20s or in the late 20s. We've seen it now. Imagine we had to wait all this time to see his full potential, the way he blocked, late bloomer.
Couple of long sets.
What are we doing,
shoulders? Shoulders and arms. Okay, it's two warm sets.
Whatever you want to do. Just get doing it.
Come on, stay with it. Get up. Easy. Come on. Again. Good. Come on. Up. Go. These two more. Four more. Come on. Okay. All right. Now slow. Come on. Two more. One more.
Two more.
Do what you do. I didn't do nothing. One more. Fight. Oh, yeah. Fight. Down slow. Yeah. I got it. Now. Huh? Stretch the body. Down. Good. Come on, stay with it. Easy, easy kick. Lock it. Down. Come on. Good. One more. Come on. Lock it up. Finish it.
Good.
Good. Good.
Good.
Lou Ferrigno, 43 years old, 310 pounds, 6 feet 5 inches, making Lou the largest bodybuilder to have ever competed. Assisted by his best friend Ira Bankowski, Lou has emerged from a 19-year retirement to compete in this year's Masters Olympia.
The main reason why I came back is because I didn't want people to think I was a has-been. I really want to turn this into my ultimate dream to be a world champion again after over the age of 40, because I never won Mr. Olympia and I want to be the best. The reason why people want to be Mr. Olympia because they want to say, I am the best built man on the planet, the world, the best of the best. There's only one Mr. Olympia. You can be Mr. Universe, you can be Mr. America, you can win the national. But Mr. Olympia means you are number one.
Let's go. 10 good ones. Hold it. There you go. Everyone's just like that. Yeah. Hold it.
Good.
Hold it.
Masters Olympia is really the Super Bowl of professional bodybuilding. It was an idea that Joe Weider had thought about for a really long time, and it was to bring back all these former greats who had been in a previous Olympia. And what it was to get all these all-time greats that many of the people remembered going back as much as 20 or 25 years to get them on stage again.
It's a long one. Two.
Well, I think that I can totally understand if anyone wants to come back and compete in the Mr. Olympia competition. It is just a very...
Arnold Schwarzenegger, seven-time Mr. Olympia.
To come back out of retirement and to get back into the swing again and to get that momentum going and the rhythm going of training and to create the hunger, which is the most important thing, to create the will and the hunger to train 4 or 5 hours a day and to be that competitive when you get to the competition, that you would do anything possible. No matter how much posing you have to do, or how much training you have to do, or how much dieting you have to do, you will do it. That is the kind of will and hunger that you need.
Go! Come on. Up. Excellent. Good. Hold it at the top.
If you fall short by 5%, you're going to lose the competition. So that's the most dangerous thing to do, is to go back and maybe not create that hunger and that will anymore. And I think that is the obstacle that Lou Ferrigno has to overcome.
The important thing is, on stage, you want to be in the best shape, but everything is in the mind. So I felt that what Ira and I put together, no one knows better than the two of us. But I put myself in a position, okay, I'm not going to fight with you for this contest. You see, I really need something to do, tell me. Because in the past, I would fight with him because I want to make sure to be a winner. I have to maximize every body part. I would pose for him after every workout. He would check my progress. But the most important thing is this time compared to years ago is the mind. Putting the mind into it, that nothing going to stop us. If you got pain, you work around the pain, you wrap it, you ice it, you got to do it.
Then the pre-judging saying in there, you have that folding.
It looks fine. It looks very good. I like it. A little bit more of a line, a little bit more separation. All right, come on, Dean. That's it. Let's go.
Chris, I think it's a real exciting contest. I know that I know I'm going to be really, I'm just really anxious to go see it. I was originally invited
Don
by
Don Ross, bodybuilding journalist.
They said that Wayne D'Amelio said he wants to keep it to just former Olympia contenders. Or people that have been in the Olympia. So what we're going to see now is people that you've read about for years and years in magazines. For the competitors themselves, it's going to be like a high school reunion. It's going to be really great. And for the rest of us, I probably have to hold back tears because it's going to be like seeing my old friends up there again. People I used to compete with, people that I read about and I interviewed years and years ago. It's going to be really nice.
The play.
Boyer Coe, 220 pounds, 5 feet 9 inches, Mr. America, 4-time Mr. Universe, and 7-time Mr. World. Originally from Rain, Louisiana, he now resides in Costa Mesa, California, and is the marketing director for a gym equipment company. At 48 years of age, Boyer believes he can defeat Lou and win the Masters Olympia title.
That's it.
For me, it's something that I've always wanted to do. I mean, being big and strong goes as far back as I was 5 years old. I used to either buy the bodybuilding magazines when I had money, and when I didn't have money, I'd steal them from the grocery store and look at the pictures. And I remember it had to have been 5 years old because I couldn't read. All I could do was look at the pictures. But at that time, and I wasn't at that time really clear that you used weights to build a big, strong body like that. I just knew that when I grew up, that's what I wanted to look like. I recall my grandfather had a barbershop, and I used to shine shoes in his barbershop, you know, when I was 14, 15 years old. And I used to tell people who I'd be shining their shoes that I was gonna be Mr. America one day. And these guys would politely look down from their newspaper and nod their heads, and I'm sure they had no idea what the hell Mr. America even was, much less this skinny little kid in front shining her shoes was gonna be Mr. America. But I believed in myself. And I think a lot of that has to do from basically everything that you do is a product of your environment, or you learn by example. And I think my parents instilled in me a very strong work ethic, and then a strong belief in myself. So I believe that anything I tackled and I continued to put forth effort in, I could accomplish it.
This is what separates the men from the boys. There's no male here. There's only one of them in here. Because the one is all we need. That's a 200-pound one. I'm talking real big. I hope I can do it.
With Brunson, he and I are about the same size, we're about the same strength level, and he, again, is very determined, has a high degree of intensity, puts everything in his workout. He pushes me, I push him. It's a friendly competition. I mean, many times, if it's just him and I in the gym, we can go through the whole workout, but probably not seeing more than, you know, how much weight you want on this exercise or something. In other words, because we're so in tune with working out.
The training part is exciting, guys.
The training is the best part. In other words, entering the Masters Miss Olympia, the motivation for me to do that is just to see how good I can get. We're using all of these months of preparation to improve. In other words, if I can step on that stage at 48 and be better than I was, say, when he and I first met back in 1981, that's a huge accomplishment to me.
What about it's true.
Well, Louis's just a big guy. I mean, if Louis didn't have the height that he had, you know, which obviously makes him stand out, I don't think you'd even notice him. It's just the fact that he's so much taller and bigger than everybody else. And undoubtedly, he enjoys a great popularity because he was fortunate enough to be in that Hulk series, you know. He has a lot of press, but as far as being a bodybuilder that I say that I fear or that I am concerned about in competition, I'm not in the least. In other words, when he decided to more or less make a comeback and compete in a Mr. Olympia 2 years ago, who was the person he turned to for advice? Me. So I'm in a sense kind of like the father telling the son what to do. So this time it's like the father competing against the son. It's like the old bull competing, or the old lion competing against the young lion. Old lion never tells all the secrets.
London's classic rock FM 96, closing out a 30-minute rock block with the tragically hip Small Town Bring Down. Brings us to 3:30 exactly, and a special treat actually going on in London. We talked about this a while ago. This is the day of the Western Ontario Bodybuilding Championship that goes on at 7 o'clock tonight at Centennial Hall. You are going to see world-class bodybuilders, and you're going to see somebody who we are actually fortunate enough to have in the studio at this very second. You may think of him as the Incredible Hulk, but Lou Ferrigno is actually his name, and he's here. Say hi.
Before I begin to say anything, every time I've done radio interviews, always when I see the disc jockey, they look like farmers. It's so nice to look at a pretty woman like you that put me at ease. I could do a nice radio interview now, like, yeah, okay, testing 1, 2, 3, 4. So anyway, it's a pleasure to be here. And I'm looking forward tonight to the post at the contest. I'm in the best shape of my life. I'm 295 pounds, 1% body fat. And the audience is going to just love it.
Now, who else is there? I was reading in the paper today, and we talked about this earlier, that you've been, after a 17-year absence, is what the paper said. Now, is this something you did as a youth? You did a lot of bodybuilding and have now come back to it, and what's up with
that? I retired years ago when I did the film Pumping Iron with Arnold Schwarzenegger because it wasn't in me anymore. I went into show business. But it was always a part of me that wanted to compete again, to be on stage, to be in my best shape. So I decided to make a comeback again.
I'm sorry, I guess this is my downfall. I don't know a lot about bodybuilding. So this is a competition tonight?
Yes, it's a competition going on tonight, different weight classes, and I'm the guest poster. Tonight I'll have more fun than competition. They're going to see something tonight they've never seen in their life before.
Yeah, I mean the first I'm Too Sexy on the song. Like
yeah, you have to find the cue.
Yeah, no problem.
But like I said, the light's going to go on. Watch me. I'm going to do this. Boom, like this, mile, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, then push the button. So.
Okay, middleweight, we're waiting for you.
Y'all ready over there? Okay, number 19, Chris Alcock.
I promise you that they'll be in the best shape of their life. But my whole goal is to come in and peak and be in my all-time best. That's why tonight is the perfect timing. So I could really get the feel of my condition with the audience. Because you're very nervous and insecure by yourself. On the day of the show, then you got problems because I've been working very hard on my posing. I want to make sure everything is falling into place.
Okay. Unbelievable.
Every day I wake up, every day I improve, I better my life. You have to believe in yourself. This is the first time I believe in myself. So I could go on stage to be a champion. I was always holding back at that fear. You see, there are a lot of athletes today that could have been phenomenon. They never achieved that because they're afraid to let go of that fear. I wanted to break every fear that came along. And you know something? I've done it. Every single fear. Coming back, getting on stage again, G-string, whatever you call it, my best shape, my legs better than ever, 40 pounds heavier. I said, nothing's gonna stop me. Nothing's gonna be in the way. I mean, if my house come down with an earthquake, nothing's gonna stop me. Take into consideration is how do you feel about yourself on stage. The most important thing to me of all is my fan. The fan is everything. The fan is the one that makes me come back. The fan is the one that's going to be there young for me. That's the power that gives me the drive to do this, knowing I can get on stage
boom, 300 pounds, and the place is like going to come apart. It's the fans, it's not the judges, it's not the promoters, it's not the magazine, it's the fans. That's what it all comes down to.
When Louis was a kid, you know, in the vicinity of 2-3 years old, he had a bunch of ear infections. No one knew anything was wrong until one day parents talked to him and he didn't respond. And from that time on, they realized there was something wrong with him. This was a real difficult time for Louis. His parents put a tremendous amount of pressure on him. The fact that he had to wear the huge hearing aid made it very uncomfortable for him and awkward. And the kids in Brooklyn were very cruel and had no sympathy for him and made it very, very difficult for him, which made him very insecure and had very low self-esteem at that particular time in his life.
I always got involved in reading comic books, like the Hulk, Spider-Man, because I was always intrigued by the muscle. I used to watch Hercules on TV, receive reads. I used to watch Superman, fantasizing that the big muscles would be a great defense for me, to protect me against my handicap. And then I got to the point that I one day discovered Joe Weider's muscle power, at the time, muscle fitness. And I realized that bodybuilders did exist, like Miss America. And subconsciously, without realizing, I knew that it was a thing for me to feel better about myself. Because when I was a young kid, they used to pick on me all the time. They used to pull my hearing aid out of my ears. They used to call me Deaf Louis, Deaf Mute. So I wanted to be strong enough and big enough that people will have respect for me. So then I took up bodybuilding. I was about 12 and a half, and I wasn't doing very well in school. They threatened to put me back one grade. So my father said to me, he says, okay, I'll make a deal with you. If you come home, you pass your grades, you keep the weights. If you don't, I'm going to throw everything out. Now, that to me, taking that away from me, is like taking everything from me. I found a way to make it through school. I knew it was hard to be in the classroom because I didn't want anybody to know that I have this hearing problem, this speech problem. I wanted to be perfect like everyone else. I cheated. I did everything I could to pass, come home with a passing report card so I can keep on training. I was just obsessed with it.
Weider Enterprises, Woodland Hills, California.
Feel it. You gotta feel it to really get the size of it. Feel the bicep. You can't tell with the eye.
I believe you.
See, the cat looks better than me.
Joe Weider, premier publisher of health and fitness magazines and founder of the Mr. Olympia competition. Joe is considered by many to be the father of bodybuilding.
Every kid has to look up to someone great. They don't have someone great ruling a sport or some great figure. You know, it doesn't have that same impact emotionally. And Lou Ferrigno, I thought following Arnold was great because he's big. He had natural potential. In fact, Arnold told me many times if I had Lou Ferrigno's genetics, he says, I would have been twice as good as I am today. The difference between him and Arnold was that Arnold had a will of iron. Lou also had a strong will, but not like Arnold. Lou vacillated more, because Lou was much more an emotional person, and Arnold was more plotting, mental, and so forth. I decided after he competed in 1975 when they made Pumping Iron that no way he was going to become anything. He'll never grow up, he'll never become an individual, he'll never be his own person as long as he lived with his father, because his father was very domineering. He see, I took an interest in him, and I tried to understand him, what his problems were and so forth, and I supported him in everything, and I encouraged him. When he got a little depressed, I told him that he can do it and so forth. I kept building him up, you know, as I do with every bodybuilder, I keep building them up and encouraging them. And Lou made an attachment because he bonds easily with people. If he can only control his emotional makeup, he can carry through what he looks like just before the contest, in the contest, he would be great and win.
This gives me a goal, a drive, and a desire to get Louis the best he can ever possibly be, for him to win this show. And that's what I want. And I want him to win the show more than anything in the world.
Well, I got to tell you, that was one of the things I really worried about this year when we started training for this thing. Because I said to him, okay, Louis, I'll train with you. But, you can't throw weights, you can't have temper tantrums, you can't do that stuff that you used to do. I knew he was going to be great. I mean, that was the one thing I knew. He had the drive and the determination. I mean, he worshipped Arnold. And the truth was, no matter how hard I pushed him, he would do it. He would train as hard as I would push him. He was not a quitter. He would really work his tail off, and I knew he wanted to be, his goal was to be Mr. Olympia.
All day,
the last one was in your best.
You're doing the opposite when you always do. Your last one's always your worst. Today, your last one's always your best.
What do you want? 10-10.
Yes.
Eddie Giuliani, manager of World Gym and longtime friend of Lou.
There's a, you know, if anybody loves bodybuilding, if you pick the top 10 guys that are in love with this bodybuilding game for longevity, the long time, the long span of it, he'd have to be way up there. You know, he's totally dedicated and in love with this. It's a part of his life, Louis, that never was fulfilled. If Louis wins or loses the Olympia, Louis will always be a champion. What he's doing now is fulfilling a dream. And the dream that he's fulfilling, it'll be fulfilled in Louis's eyes. But that's what he's doing. He's fulfilling a personal dream of himself. As far as the people go, Louis is, you know, another planet. And so Louis is a superstar right now. Louis will always be a champion.
Well, I think Lou is not, to me, he's big, but he's not symmetrical, you know. He's awesome, but if you really come down to body parts, it's just one good body part. I think it's his traps. That's it, you know. As far as Boyer, he has everything, you know, a little of this, a little of that. It's like a good all-around package.
That's why I never even worried too much about it.
If you want to talk about the best bodybuilders in the world, I will probably be, in one instance, go down in history as the best bodybuilder in the world because of one reason. I will outlast everybody. I've been doing this now going on 35 years. 35 years from now, if I'm alive, I'll still be doing this. I'll be training with the same enthusiasm simply because I love to train. Well, to me, like taking the Masters contest that's coming up, I don't care if the prize money is $25,000, $25, or 25 cents or a blue ribbon. I'm just going there because the contest is only a measure, a yardstick for me to see if at 48 years old I can be better than I was ever before in my life. That's my motivation. And I don't care if I come out first or dead last in the contest. What I'm looking for is to accomplish that goal of being better than I've ever been before. And then you say, well, how do you gauge that? It's certainly not by the judges. I really don't care what the judges think of me, because once I step on the stage, I don't have any control of what the judges. All I can do is prepare myself best, the best I can. What I'm looking for is the people that I respect, who have known me all my life in this sport, who will tell me the truth and say, if that contest is over with and they say, hey, you know, you looked better than you've ever looked before, then that's the satisfaction I get out of it. But it's the total result that you get from being the best you can be. Because you got to look at it. A contest, a bodybuilding contest, is only a matter of an opinion of some other people, of you. Basically, what you're doing is standing up there almost totally naked saying, hey, I hope you like me better than the next guy. I like Louis, although I think Louis is a very frustrated individual. There is, and there probably always will be, a certain amount of resentment, from Louis towards Arnold because of the way the Pumping Iron movie kind of made Louis look. And I think now, by instituting this Masters, he's looking for a win, because originally when they first started talking about this, the cutoff point was 45 years old and above. And I think that Louis had something to do with convincing Joe to lower the age to 40 so he would be allowed to enter, which is fine. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I don't give a damn who enters.
Hello? Yeah? Oh, Joe, we're okay.
It's a hole.
Must read my mind every time in the middle of training. Let's see what you want. You probably want to know how my project is going. I'm working on my program. Hi, Joe, how you doing? What's happening? Well, I came out, I had no money. I received only, I think, $200 or $300 for the guest posting fee. I was so determined not to go home because I figured it was my only chance to stay in California. So I slept on the beach for 2 weeks. I had no money because, you know, food really adds up. I called Joe, I begged Joe, I said, Joe, please, I don't want to go home. Please give me a contract. I really want to stay here. I want to train for the Mr. Olympia. I convinced him that I was not going to leave bodybuilding. So from that time on, I started to do posing exhibitions to make California my home, like a dream coming true, because I know going home, I was not going to be a happy person. And Joe, I mean, saved my life.
Okay. All right, Joe, bye-bye.
Now, you see, when I brought him here, I thought at that time he would be able to pull himself together. And I worked with him, I encouraged him, and was preparing him to enter the Miss Olympia. And I believe that he would have won at that time because, you know, who he was competing against. They were not these great champions. They were not that heavily developed. His size, his muscularity was awesome. And if he trained a whole year, I was sure that he was going to win the Olympia and for a couple of years thereafter.
Back in the times in Brooklyn, I was a different person. I lied about my parents, saying, I even thought I had perfect parents. I even thought I had the kind of family like you would see on Father Knows Best. It wasn't like that in my house. It was the opposite. I carry all her guilt and anger because he projected all the feelings on me, because he had other friends who were policemen. They raved about their son. My son is in school. My son is doing this. He'd get this on the test, and then he would come home and say, look at my son, this and this, which is sad, but I think the fact that he could not relate to me to having a handicap, so instead, he resented himself, probably hated himself, the fact that he had an imperfect son, that he did something wrong.
So we have really no bond, no connection. Well, you know, the sad thing is, when I was the champion, I was the winner. I thought he loved me. He couldn't accept me losing. He only showed interest if there was ways of making money, for me getting attention, but he couldn't see his son losing. He can't accept defeat. You know, we had many incidents. I mean, it was like a love and hate relationship. Everything my father wanted to be, imagined to be, I've become. He said, if you had your hearing, you're going to be a great athlete. If you had your hearing, you'd be a popular like Arnold Schwarzenegger. If you had your hearing, you would have been you'd be doing this. He didn't have the self-esteem to do all this. I've done it. When I was born, I lost 85% of my hearing. I couldn't speak. I could not hear. I was very introverted. I decided to try bodybuilding. It gave me such a good feeling about myself. It made me feel strong because as a kid, they used to call me deaf mute. So I thought I was dumb, I was stupid because I didn't have my hearing. But when I started to lift weights, I said to myself, I'm going to be so big, so strong someday, nobody's going to pick on me. I guess I did a little, I've gone too far in that direction.
You know, you always see him on TV, but you never get the chance to see him in person.
This was your birthday present to come here to this show.
Yeah.
To come see Lou or the show?
Lou.
Yeah.
Lou, yeah.
Why come see Lou, though? Why Lou Ferrigno?
Big fan.
Well, he's like my idol.
Your idol.
Yeah.
So.
I like it. It's great, yeah.
Those arms are massive. Like, I mean, I sit there and look at my arms and I go, shit, look at the size of his arms.
Yeah, how big do you think his arms are?
His arms are even bigger. Like
how big his arms are?
Well, both of them.
Well, it says
bigger
they're,
than
they're 23 and a half.
I'm in my
plus. Aren't they? 23 and a half plus?
Push more. Go more. Good.
See, to me, one of the things that's the biggest problem today, I would think, with young kids, is the fact that they don't have any goals. Now, my goal, granted, was an oddball goal to win the Mr. America contest. Now, I didn't really care how insignificant or how unimportant that was to somebody else. It was a goal for me. It was my goal. So that, I think, contributed a lot to me working towards something, which kept me out of trouble in other aspects. At 17 years old, at 180 pounds, back in 1964, I had bench pressed over 400 pounds. And I would, at that time, there wasn't too many kids 18 years old that could do that. So I developed very fast and I matured as far as muscularity and so forth is concerned. So I actually, like, I won the Mr. America contest at 21. You have to understand something. I developed very fast. In other words, I was basically, I would say, very adapt or perfect for bodybuilding. My father was one who never had an opportunity to get involved in lifting weights, but he encouraged me. Actually, when I first started, he always was with me at all of the bodybuilding competitions I went to, and I traveled all over the South, you know, competing in the very beginning. And I would say that he never pushed me into it, and he never drove, because his primary importance was that I should place all my emphasis on education. But he never discouraged me from lifting weights.
What is? See, Louis thinks this is water. This is really a secret. This is vodka.
Oh. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I was happy to be a member of R&J Health Club, but he had the kind of personality back then. He was a big sports fan. I think I was in the wrong business. To me, it's like he shouldn't have been another Vince Lombardi. But anyway, I was training with Kenny Thompson back then. His wife got pregnant. He goes, listen, I can't train with you, but he's going to have a good training partner named Ivory. You should try to train with him. He'll be great for you. So I went to the gym. I called him up. We met. We took our first workout. It was an arm workout. We finished the workout with dips. And it went like this. Great. From that day on, it was like two gears that just clicked perfect. It was magic.
When I first met Louie,
but when that met him, when we really started training together, we became instant friends. And it really kind of struck me that like Louis really didn't have very many, if any, friends. And the one or two that he did have, he wasn't really close to me. From the time we started training, it became me. He sort of lived in this sheltered life that his father put around him, and his world was bodybuilding. His whole thing, or one of his main things, was to go out to prove I can be the best at something. There's nothing wrong with me. I'm okay. And I'll do whatever it takes to prove that I'm okay and I'm a winner.
It has been really difficult raising a family and getting ready for this contest and helping Lou through it. I never had any thoughts about what competition would be like to be involved in it with Lou. I had thought about his past and saw Pumping Iron and heard stories about bodybuilders who have done competitions, but I never had a clue as to what it would really be like. I didn't marry a bodybuilder, I married an actor. My gut reaction to Lou saying to me, I'm going to do the Masters, was kind of an excitement, because I've lived with him all these years. I know what bodybuilding has meant to him. I know how people love him. I know how much they love him being a bodybuilder. So my initial reaction was, yes, you know, do it and fulfill your dreams. Do what you gotta do. But when it was said and done, I hadn't bargained for all that it would take, all the selfishness, all the raising the children by myself, being an only parent, because that's really what I was. I mean, I was an only parent to these kids. When it came to bodybuilding, I was out of the picture, completely out of the picture. I didn't do the food, I didn't do the posing stuff with him, I couldn't train with him, I couldn't do anything with him as far as that went. Or did I want to? I cared that he would get to achieve something that he'd always dreamed of. I cared about that. I cared about how he felt about it. But I didn't care about the reality of every day, the posing, the food, the diet, the stress from it. But this, I just removed myself from. It was too hard.
I'll tell you one thing. I predict that Lou Ferrigno's going to win. But like I told Louis, it's not going to be a cakewalk. It's going to be a fight. It's going to be a battle. He's going to have some top, top guys, some legends. He better have his posing down. He better have his definition in there perfect. He better have as much size as he possibly can, because those guys are going to be battling him tooth and nail. These are the Masters.
My belief is that if you want to compete in a world championship competition like the Mr. Olympia, that you don't have to get your mind together, because you have the mind together, and you have the will, and you have the motivation and the drive and the vision to see yourself as the winner or forget about the whole thing. It's you have it in you that you're meant to win this contest, then that faith in yourself and that vision that you have of winning, that is what will carry you there. That is what will take you through the hours and hours of working out, through the pounds and tons of lifting weights. But if you have to first get your act together and first have to set your mind, that means that you didn't have it.
I just think he's just all around better. It bothers me when they say Louis is just big, because Louis, for a guy 6'5", there's never been a bodybuilder that tall who has shape, symmetry, proportion, a great set of abdominals, great arms, chest, back. Louis has it all.
It's a matter of life or death. my goal is, and our goal is to be, for me to be on stage and say, hey, we can't do anymore. I do not intend to be in the Mass Olympia for 4 or 5 years. It's like one time, but I want to come like in King Kong and be in the best shape.
Lou Ferrigno is in a very comfortable position right now. He has a wonderful family. He has an incredible wife. He has lovely children. He makes money. He lives in a wonderful house. It's all comfortable. And therefore, that makes it the biggest obstacle to compete in a Mr. Olympia or in any sports competition as far as it goes. You've got to be hungry, and there ought to be no safety net there. And that is when you become the most fierce in competing and the most fierce of a competitor.
You can't help but be drawn to the largest individual on stage, and he, I mean, overshadows everybody by far, simply because of the height and the size that he is. I don't think the quality of his physique is outstanding as his sheer height and size. I'm going there to do my absolute best. I can't control the outcome. I mean, if I could, I'd say, yeah, I'm going to win. But I'd be foolish in telling you that because I can't control the judge's mind. I will tell you this much. I'll be the best that I can be on that particular day.
Boyer Cohen, these guys have said, look, he says, remember when we competed, there was no money in it at all. And we did it for the fun of the sport, so that's why we're doing it now. And I think that's it with Louis. Louis's got something to prove to himself. Louis came within a hair of winning the Mr. Olympia contest, and Louis needs a Mr. Olympia contest. In a sense, it makes you immortal. It puts you in history. It makes you an important part of bodybuilding history. And if you drop dead the next day, you live forever in the annals of bodybuilding history. It makes you immortal.
Morning.
Hi, Louie.
Is Mr. Dr. Weiss here?
Yeah,
thanks. Oh, boy.
Hey, Lou.
How you
I'll
doing?
Be right with
you. I guess we're getting down to the wire. Got a few more weeks.
Yeah, I know. Getting close, man.
Well, we got to look on the hip. It's just like, like this, you know?
Well, you're on schedule, buddy. Come on in.
Okay.
All the way to the back, on the left. Seen anybody else? No, all the way in the back on the left.
No, I haven't been able to see anybody, but I just know everybody's training hard. I don't know why the last couple of days my
A lot of these top-level bodybuilders are just crazy. They really push themselves to the point of overtraining almost all the time.
Shooting pain here.
You know, bodybuilding's a mentality all to its own, especially at that top level, and there's quite a number of injuries. You know, they're pushing their bodies to the absolute limits.
Well, we'll fix you up.
These guys, they want to win, you know. Unfortunately, top level athletics, you know, in the country, in almost every field, is not that healthy. They push themselves to win no matter what happens to their body. Lou's one of the biggest, he's one of the thickest. He's really hard to adjust, this, you know, especially his lower back. I sent him for some x-rays and they had a tough time getting the x-rays through him because he's so thick and it's all muscle. You know, they figured out the factors it would take to x-ray somebody his size, and it didn't work. They had to, like, triple it because somebody his size is usually fat. He's 310 pounds of muscle. So, yeah, it's definitely a challenge to work on. Just relax, man. Just relax, man. Just relax.
Did you ever think there'd come a time where all you guys would be getting back together almost 20 years later,
now you're
on stage?
I never could conceive of something like this, of being the Masters Mr. Olympia. And as soon as that opportunity came, I remember Jerry Branum called me on the phone and says, Bill, it's coming, it's going to happen. I said, who do I call? I got to find out. I found out in April, and I mean, I was already training, but I mean, the intensity of my training stepped up. I mean, just to be back with the boys again, I mean, There it is. Ed Corney, man. Mike Katz.
I think what's going to be kind of nice is that...
Mike Katz, a former Mr. Universe who is presently an IFBB official scheduled to judge tomorrow's competition.
Stadium with guys that can hardly run to first base. I mean, that's not what we're going to see.
We're going to see some
quality. But you're going to see some great athletes that would be in the top 10 in the Mr. Olympia the following day. So this is not, you know, we're just getting together some gray-haired or no-haired guys, you know, I mean, once competed. I mean, there's a great group of athletes, and I think what's going to happen is not only is a younger audience who never saw this other than in Pumping Iron, or may have heard about it from their dad, you know what I mean, from years ago, or saw the old magazines, now they're going to see it, you know, live, in person.
Play the music, and then I will walk out, because the intro is me walking on.
To go all the way to the end of your routine. Yes. And your room number is?
1006.
1006. Everybody knows now.
Well, I feel very confident. In other words, if I was trying to come back after a 10-year layoff, then I would feel more anxiety. But, I mean, as I said earlier in the press conference, I haven't changed anything in the last 10 years. I've trained just as hard as I would if I would have been competing. So I didn't really have to do anything special to get in shape for this contest. And one of the things that I feel very good about is after training some 34 years, and doing a lot of things right, a lot of things wrong, I believe at 48, and I hope to prove that tomorrow, that this is the best shape I've ever been in my life.
God forbid, I'm hoping I don't control a blank when
Bill
I get
Grant,
up.
Bill Grant, 45 years old, 225 pounds, 6 feet tall, a Mr. America and Mr. World who came out of retirement to compete in tomorrow's event.
You kind of miss it when you're not there. You miss that crowd roaring, and when you're on that stage, I mean, it's just you. Everybody's focused in on you, and you feel great when you hear that noise and you get that adulation, and you walk off stage and it's like, wow, here I am again.
Go ahead.
You just got
that. All right. You're walking up with the pulses. Okay. All right. Good. Hips flexed. Okay. There you go. Great.
When you were a little kid, did you want to be Mickey Mantle or Willie Mays? I see, I come from New York, so I wanted to be Mickey Mantle. So I dreamt when I was 10 years old about walking in center field, you know, in Yankee Stadium by the monuments. Louis was not a big avid sports fan. Louis' thing from a real early age was bodybuilding, and it was Larry Scott when Louis was 15 years old. And that was his driving force. He wanted to be Mr. Olympia, and the fact that he was never able to get it because of the way life's twists and turns happen was why he wanted this much this year.
That's awesome.
That's
perfect.
That's it, man.
All right, keep that up.
All right.
For Lou to feel complete, I think that winning would really do it. For about an hour. You know, if you're asking me that question, I think he already is complete. But he doesn't really know it yet. He thinks that this competition is what will make him the ultimate complete man. And I think, you know, I don't want to miss sight of who he is. It's kind of a selfish answer, because I've never been there. I haven't walked in his shoes in this area. And I think that, yes, it would be a great completion for his life to have that, truly. I think he would eventually see that it wasn't the answer to all of his happiness or unhappiness. But I think it would be a great feather in his cap.
I'm really excited that they're having the first ever Masters Olympian. You know, as each day goes by, I'm getting more excited.
Lonnie Tepper, renowned bodybuilding journalist and sports commentator.
We're talking about almost 20 years ago, and you had a young guy like Lou Ferrigno, 24 years old. I think he was 256, 258 pounds. I did an interview with the guy a month ago. He's 298 pounds, veins all over the place, his abs are in. In my column, I predict Robbie Robinson to win this show, but I'm starting to think, you know what, LT? You maybe have made a mistake, a very big mistake, because that's one huge monster there. And I think of Lou Ferrigno as the Hulk on TV, this big green monster coming out of your screen into your living room, and now he's going to be coming out of the posing day right into my seat in the front row. I can't wait.
It's like old camaraderie. The whole gang coming together, participating in an event, reliving a lot of the past. It's really great to see all the fellas again, and I'm anxious to see what they look like and what they have accomplished.
All right, Boyer, here. Bernard Salette, here. Chris Dickerson, here. Lou Ferrigno's here.
Yes.
Herman Hoffman, here. Olaf Arms, here. Danny Padilla, here.
Louis was ready. Louis was as ready as one human being could be for a contest. And I know that we've done everything in my mind, in my heart, in his mind, in his heart, to do everything we could to have him be